Hi everyone, we warmly welcome all who are joining from around the world to this webinar, What's New in WSO2 Enterprise Integrator 660. I'm Samir Gunaratne, and with me I have Malak Ganganandha from WSO2 Integration team presenting this webinar. Please raise the question throughout the webinar and we will answer them at the end. So let's move on to the webinar presentation. We are pleased to announce the release of WSO2 Enterprise Integrator 660. First of all, let's recap on WSO2 EI profile in brief before moving into all important new features. WSO2 EI consists of unified integration and data integration runtimes, also a comprehensive tooling distribution which supports both runtimes. This release aims at addressing long-awaited JDK 11 compatibility. In addition, new product improvements include a built-in test framework with comprehensive tooling support. Apart from that, this release brings set of new product components and features, which we are going to discuss later in this webinar. Previously, WSO2 integration platform consisted of set of individual servers which fulfill different needs in enterprise integration. ESB as the central service bus, which handles integration, and data services server for exposing databases as services, business process server to implement long-running workflows inside an enterprise, also the message broker as a messaging enterprise middleware. Most of the time, to build integration solutions, we are using more than one product. In 2017, we decided to repackage all the enterprise integration products all together and release a single product called WSO2 Enterprise Integrator. That is done to make the user experience a better one. Enterprise Integrator has several key areas, which are service integration, data integration, business processes, and messaging. Those areas can fulfill any integration needs in the enterprise. So as we discussed in the previous slide, to achieve the key integration areas, we have repackaged the set of products into several profiles. Integration profile will provide both service and data integration capabilities within a single runtime. Then the business process profile is the runtime we can use to implement long-running business workflows within an organization. The message broker profile can be used to facilitate message brokering use cases of an organization, which will achieve guaranteed delivery and reliable messaging scenarios. The analytics profile, by default, is configured to monitor statistics related to the message mediation that is carried out by the integration runtime. Now let's look at the service integration capability of the integrator profile. As you all know, WSO2 Integrator profile is comprised with a lightweight, high-performing enterprise service bus based on Apache Synapse open source ESB. It provides a wide range of features supporting almost all the standard integration protocols such as REST, SOAP, and some domain-specific protocols like SAP, FIX, etc. WSO2 EI has 100% support for all the enterprise integration patterns as well. So next, we'll look at the data integration capability of the integrator runtime. In fact, data services runtime is merged with ESB runtime. So data services provides features to expose your databases as services. Also, it supports a wide range of relational and non-relational databases. So not only the databases, it will allow us to expose data stored in other data sources like the Microsoft Excel sheets, Google spreadsheets, etc. We can even combine data from multiple data sources and expose it as a single service using the data services runtime. As we looked in the previous slides, the integrated runtime is for short-running stateless integrations. So for long-running stateful integrations, which are basically called processors, we can use business process runtime to execute those. You can implement business workflows using BPL, BPMN, and human tasks as the workflow implementation standard. You can implement the business process workflows using the graphical tooling available with the WSO2 Integration Studio and deploy them to business process runtime. So in your integration solution, if you have any kind of long running process, you can use the business process profile to implement those. We will look at the tooling capabilities of the Enterprise Integrator now. We provide graphical tooling capabilities based on Eclipse runtime to Enterprise Integrator profile and business process profile. So using the integrator tooling, you will be able to design your mediation flow by dragging and dropping different mediation artifacts such as mediators, connectors into the canvas provided. You can get hands on with WSO2 Integrator tooling by starting from the sample templates provided in the Getting Started option. Once you have developed a mediation flow, you can connect to a local or remote server to deploy them via tooling itself. Also, you will be able to debug the mediation flow using the tooling by connecting to a local or remote EI server. As the latest feature addition to the EI tooling is the unit test suite, which we can use to write unit tests for the mediation artifacts. So we will discuss this in detail in later slide. So let's now come to our main focus of this webinar to provide you an idea about what's new with the Enterprise Integrator 6.6.0 release. There are many new features and improvements that have been shipped with this EI 6.6.0 release. So these are the new features that have been introduced with the EI 6.6.0 release. So we have introduced JDK 11 compatibility, a unit testing framework for writing unit tests for Synapse artifacts, Swagger UI feature and Fry tool for APIs, and cross-origin resource support for APIs, JSON transform mediator as a new mediator, the comprehensive content native feature support, and BPMN read tasks for the BPS runtime. And for the tracing purposes, we have introduced the Jaeger tracing support with this release. We will look into details in them in coming slides. So the JDK 11 compatibility in this release, one of the key focus was to provide the JDK 11 compatibility to Enterprise Integrator profiles. So it will enable the enterprises to migrate their integration solutions to the latest LTS JDK version. Our product installers are now shipped with OpenJDK 11 by default, so that users can easily try out Enterprise Integrator on top of JDK 11. Another key feature that is shipped with Enterprise Integrator 6.6.0 is the unit testing framework for the Synapse mediation artifacts. With this feature, you will be able to write unit tests for the mediation flows you are developing. Basically, we support write unit tests for following mediation artifacts, which are proxy services, APIs, and sequences. This unit test suite will assert the tests on three phases of deployment, the mediation, and the assertion of the response. So it will help to make sure if any issues can happen at artifact deployment, mediation runtime, and for the response. So let's hop into a recorded demo on how to use the unit testing framework to write mediation artifact tests. So we will be looking to this demo. So first, let's create a sample ESB solution project called Hello World project. So after creating finish, we will be creating a proxy service which simply creates a message using the payload factory and responds back to the client. We will name the proxy service as the Hello World scenario. So here we will be configuring a payload factory to create a payload as a Hello World and just respond it back to the client. So then we select the artifact, and then we can create the unit test suite by right clicking on that. We will just give a name like test suite Hello World. And here we can give the supportive artifacts, which you, if you have any registry artifacts or endpoints, you can give it them there. Then in this unit test suite, you can have a mock services, you can have support artifact details, and you can create the test cases here using this plus button. And we will create a test case as test case one, and you can give the input payload to your mediation flow, and you can configure the input properties, and also you can give the assertion values here as an expression, and here we are asserting the payload body, and we can give the expected value, and for the error message we can configure it as when to show it for the failure scenario. So let's add it, and let's create the test case. And if you switch back to the source view, you can see the generated test case. And then you can run the test using right-clicking on the test artifact. You can give the run unit test option. So here you can configure the inbuilt micro integrator, which is shipped with the integrator studio, or you can give a local remote server to run the test suite. So here we are up and running a EI60 server. So we have to run it, enable the test mode using the Synapse test parameter, and you can give the test port which the test suite will be connected. So the by default the port will be 9008. So we will wait for the server up and running. Once the test suite is connected, you will see this Synapse unit testing agent has been established on the given port. And we can now connect to the remote server and run the test case. So now we can see it's running. So as you can see, we can see the assertion has been passed for this test case. Both the deployment and mediation phases also has been passed. Now let's create a failure scenario by changing the expected value, and let's see how it will validate the payload. And let's run the unit test again. Now it will be run, and the assertion will be failed. Both the deployment and mediation has been passed, but the assertion will be failed because the payload has been mismatched. You can also see the logs in the console. So now the demo has been over. Describe about the JSON transform mediator, I will hand over the presentation to Marlo.
So, hi guys. prior to introducing JSON Transform Mediator, we should discuss what are the reasons behind designing it. So WSO2EI, actually WSO2ESB, started in a time where SOAP services dominated the internet. Now more than 10 years later, we are in a REST-dominated world where JSON is more powerful. Though ESB has evolved to EI, the core still uses SOAP as a canonical form. This means even when we are working with a JSON payload, it is converted to SOAP before processing. This back and forth conversion has introduced several problems in the past. For an example, losing array information, also known as single element array converted to an object, losing data type information when converted to JSON, problems in handling null values. So with the adoption of JSON, ESB was equipped with some configuration to fix these problems, but these properties do not allow any fine-tuned changes. For an example, let's consider the auto primitive property, which will enable us to automatically detect and pass values to primitives. So we might need auto primitives to be enabled for one proxy and disabled for another. So with this auto primitive property, we cannot do that because it is globally applied property. Also, there can be a reason where we need to auto primitive detection for selected keys only, which is also not possible. So as a solution, we have given native JSON support for the EI. In EI 660 onwards, it contains the native JSON support for all possible mediators, such as aggregate mediator, enrich mediator, for each mediator, and iterate mediator. So if we are give native JSON support, why do we need a separate JSON transform mediator? The answer is, the JSON to XML conversion is mandatory in some cases, and it's a part of our mediation flow as well. Example, we have an XSLT mediator in the middle. We need to convert JSON to XML and XML to JSON. The issues mentioned above will still remain when doing this. So to solve these issues, while XML to JSON transformation, we need to have a JSON transform mediator. So here gives the schema of JSON transform mediator. The JSON transform mediator is the newest addition to the mediator collection in EI, which is introduced to resolve the above described issues in the prior slide. So JSON transform mediator is capable of formatting JSON message in the mediation flow according to a given schema, properties, or both. So usually the JSON transformation mediator is expected to be used at the end of a mediation flow. For an example, transform the XML payloads to a JSON payload just before responding or sending it to endpoint. So here we are transforming the current message according to a given schema. For an example, we can change the data type of the value from string to int for a given key only by using JSON schema. Previously, if you use the auto primitive property, it will be applied to all the keys which can be converted to a primitive. But here with the schema, we can only define a rule for one single key. So here we can configure one or more properties with the required values. This enables us to use those properties which earlier applied in a system-wide scope now to a sequence level scope, which means we can enable the auto primitive in one proxy and we can disable it in another proxy. So here in this configuration, we have applied properties and the schema as well. So the properties get applied first and the schema applied afterwards. For an example, suppose we can get the majority of the changes done using properties. For the rest of the selected fields which require to be changing, we can use the schema. For a simple example, if we have five keys and we need to convert four of them into the primitives and one into a string, what we can do is we can provide disable auto primitive false for the property, and in the schema we can just give a single rule where we need to have the string key value. So that's the advantage of giving both the schema and property. So also with EA660, we have introduced comprehensive container native features like environment variable support for all environment dependent parameters, environment variable support for property mediator, environment variable support to server configuration files, and also Docker secret support for secure vault. So we will discuss them in detail in the following slides. So injecting parameters as environment variables. What are the issues we are facing when deploying Synapse artifacts in different environments? When deploying integration artifacts in different environments, it is necessary to change the Synapse parameters used in the artifacts according to that environment. For an example, value for the endpoint URL given in your integration artifacts should be specific for each environment. This feature allows you to deploy the same integration solution to multiple environments and then inject separate parameter values to the different end. This particularly useful for container deployments where we need to dynamically inject the parameter values to containers. So if you look into the following sample, here the address, the URI of the address endpoint is parameterized. So it can be defined as $system colon the parameter key as the parameter value. This parameter key represents a placeholder representing the parameter. So you can deploy this artifact in separate environments. You don't need to change the artifact, but you can just inject the stock code EP key and actual endpoint in the as a environment variable. For more details, you can follow the given doc link. So here we have listed some support endpoint parameters which are supported. For the address endpoint, HTTP endpoint, and the template endpoints, we have supported URI. So you can parameterize the URI. For the load balance endpoint and recipient list endpoint, you can parameterize both hostname and the port. And for the whistle endpoint, the whistle URI. The sample is given below. So if you go into the data service parameters, the driver, URL, username, password can be parameterized. Sample is given below. If you take schedule task, you can parameterize the pin service. For the listener proxies like JMS parameters, fixed parameters, mail to parameters, and the given list, you can parameterize. Also, you can follow the doc link as well. For the inbound endpoints like HTTP, HTTPS, HL7, and etc., you can parameterize as well. So, here we have listed supported message store parameters as well. So, in the next, we have environment variable support for the property mediator. Previously, we have given the ability to read properties from system properties in property mediator. Now, we have developed it that we have given the support to read environment variables in property mediator as well. So in the given sample, and when we define the scope as env, you can read from the environment variable. So currently, the given files support parameterized configuration with system properties. Access to XML, carbon XML, master data source XML, and user management XML. With EI660 release, we have given the environment variable support for it as well. For an example, if we parameterize as given sample, the precedence will be given to the environment variable. So if we define environment variable as system server host name, it will be get picked. Then if it hasn't been defined, a system property will be taken, and if not, the hard-coded value will be taken. So it is the environment variable support for server configuration files. And finally, we have the Docker secret support for secure. So there is a requirement to read secrets such as encrypted or plain text from a file or Docker secret in container-based deployment. So for that, we have improved existing WSO2 world lookup implementation. So next, here we have a sample as well. So next, to talk about core support for APIs, I will hand over the presentation to Samir.
So core support is important when an web application executes a cross-origin HTTP request and it requests a resource that has a different origin, like a domain, protocol, or port from its own origin. So now you can apply the core configurations to the APIs exposed in the EI server. So you can configure them in the synapse.properties file in the repository, the conf directory in the EI server. And as in the shown example, you can configure the allowed course origins in the access control allow origin property in the synapse.properties file. So the BPMA read task feature is introduced for the business process profile of the enterprise integrator. So read task is a custom BPMA activity that is capable of reading resources from a source and populate it to a given variable. Now users will be able to refer to the values from registry resources, environment variables, and system variables within the BPMN workflow using the read task. So as in this diagram, so you can use the BPMN read task in your business process flow by drag and dropping the task from the palette, and you can configure the BPMN task properties, which are resource origin, the target variable, and the variable type. So the resource origin is basically from the which source you need to get the resource from. The allowed values are registry, environment, and system. The target variable is where the content read from the task is populated, and you can give the type of the content stored in the target variable using the type property. So in this release, we have focused on giving the fine-grained tracing support using the Jaeger tracing. So tracing provides a vital information regarding the round trip of a service invocation of EI mediation flows. So Jaeger is a well-known CNCF graduated in implementation based on the open tracing standard. So once you enable statistics monitoring and message tracing for Jaeger, you can trace a message including the message payload throughout the mediation flow. Once the trace data is available, the published data can then be visualized via the JDK UI. So in this slide, you can see how tracing data is viewed from the JDK UI for a mediation flow that we use in EI server. So now we have concluded on the new features that has been shipped with EI 660 release. So let's move on to the Q&A session of this webinar regarding the new release. So if you have any questions, you can raise now. We will look for the answers.
So there's a question, where is it possible to use Ballerina to implement a service inside an EI profile runtime? Actually, EI profile or the integration profile is based on the configuration driven integration. So it is not possible to use Ballerina to implement the service inside the EI profile. And there's another question. Can I read the properties file to get the values related to different environments? Yes, you can. Actually, there is another new feature which relates to injecting parameters using environment variables. That feature is injecting parameters using configuration files. Using that feature, it is a new feature as well, you can inject parameters using a configuration file. When you are starting the integration profile, you can define a file, and in that file you can give the key value pair.
So we have another question. So does WSO2 ES supports per API cost configuration? So we don't support that per API configurations. The cost configurations are applied globally to the server, since it is applied from the synapse.properties file. However, if the APIs are called from like different hosts, the cost will be applied according to the access control allow origin configuration. So basically the cost configurations are applied globally to the server, and we cannot configure it per API.
So there is another question, the environment variables will be in the micro indicator. Yes, the environment variable support is in the micro integrator as well. So there's another question actually, why do we need to have both schema and property support for JSON transform mediator? The thing is, as I explained before, if you, for an example, if you have 5 key JSON payload, and you need to, if 4 of them need to be primitives and a single one needs to be a stream, if you are going to do it with a single schema, you need to provide 5 rules. But rather than that, what you can do is you can define a single property disable auto primitive false, and for that single key where you need to be a string, you can give the schema. So that's the benefit of that. So actually there is a question, what do if someone used in-out mediators? In this release, they are thing is, we have deprecated in the prior releases and now we have removed it actually.
So we have another question. Now that we have properties that can be environment specific, is there still some benefit to use registry to configure endpoints URL? So actually, using the registry, we can we'll be able to since it will be stored in a DB, we can able to refer the registry between different JVMs. So that would be the key benefit using the registry for where such as we cannot use the containers container specific environments. It is the registry is useful rather than the environment specific variables. So there's another question. So why EI66 when there are 70? So basically EI70 is the version that the more focused on the containerized environments. And also with the EI70 we are not supporting the BPS profile and the message broken profile. So the in the EI66 release that will be continued to with all those profiles. So also the clustering also will be for the on-premise environments, the EI66 6X the release series will be useful since it's also available the clustering configurations. So the EI7 is more specific on the containerized environments. That's what the main motive on that. So we have also a Slack channel that we have mentioned in this slide, so you can join to our Slack channel to provide your questions and give us your thoughts on the EI660 release. And we are warmly welcome you to our Slack channel to forward your questions on regarding the EI matters. So since we have answered the questions, let's wrap up this webinar.
We will send you the Slack channel invitation in the chat as well.
Yeah, we have posted the Slack channel invite in the GoToWebinar chat. And let's wrap up this webinar session. Have a good day.
Yeah. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, guys.